how to select a room on campus. In order to be eligible for room selection, you will need to complete the housing application form, submit the $50 housing application fee, submit the required immunization paperwork, and have registered for orientation. If you would like to participate in room selection with a set of roommates, you will need to create a roommate group. To create a roommate group, you will need to access the roommate group manager in the housing portal. Visit our website to learn more about the roommate group manager tool. If you would like to select a room without a roommate, you will not need to form or join a roommate group. If you are participating in room selection during the first few days of room selection opening, you will be sent a date and start time to your USF email. You will not be able to access this system before this time. Be sure to explore our housing options page in order to better understand the housing styles and communities that work best for you. Make sure to explore these options before you select a room to be prepared. When the time has come for you to access the room selection system, go to usf.edu/housing and select Housing Portal. Once in the Housing Portal, select Assign. Once on the Assign page, select your desired term. From here, select the Room Selection option. Once on the Room Selection page, you will indicate if you are part of the Special Population Room Selection Group or a part of the General Room Selection Group. You are now in the room selection system. If applicable, be sure to confirm your roommate group members at this step before continuing with room selection. Please be aware that room rates may fluctuate from term to term. Once in the room selection search page, you now have access to look for your room. You have the ability to search using specific criteria or by living area. The image on the right side of the page will show you what areas you are selecting. Buildings, floors, floor plans, and what rooms are available. You now may select your space and have 5 minutes to confirm this selection. Within those 5 minutes, the space you selected will no longer be available to others viewing room selection options. If you don't want to choose this space, you may pick a different room. If you choose to pick a different room, you will be taken back to the room selection page and you will no longer have a hold on that space. If you are the leader of a roommate group, you may assign your roommates into their spaces at this step as well. The same 5-minute rule applies. Once you have made your selection, scroll down and hit Continue. You will now be prompted to review the details of your room selection before submitting and confirming your selection. Congratulations! You have now finished your room selection. Welcome home!
Coming to you from the beautiful University of South Florida campus in Tampa, it's USF Housing Live!
Welcome to the Season 7 premiere of USF Housing Live. I'm your host, Julia O'Hara, with Housing and Residential Education at the beautiful University of South Florida in Tampa. We have an exciting season planned to help you prepare for college. Throughout this season, we'll be covering the on-campus experience, academic success, dining, financial aid, and so much more. So be sure to join us on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Eastern to hear from campus experts and have your questions answered live on the show. So to kick off the season of Housing Live, we'll be talking all about the on-campus residential experience at USF. We are joined by Assistant Vice President of USF Housing and Residential Education, Anna Hernandez, and later in the show, David Kloiber, the Associate Director for Operations and Outreach, will be joining us. So be sure to drop your questions in the comments from wherever you're watching, and we'll respond to as many as we can throughout the show. So welcome, Anna. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to join you.
We're so happy to have you back and starting this season out. So let's jump right in if you're ready.
Sure.
Okay, awesome. So let's talk about what some of the benefits are to living on campus at USF.
Well, our motto at USF is that housing and residential education is the best place to live, the best place to work, and the best place to learn. And I think that that really encapsulates the experience that we offer. It's all about community, it's about convenience, and it's about academic success. We really want students to live on campus and experience the Bulls life and all that that entails.
So when you're living on campus, can you talk about some of the support elements that residents have? And then when we're on that topic, let's talk about those interested in living on campus. So some of the folks joining us tonight might be potential students that are coming to the university, potential residents. So what type of support is in the halls for our current residents? And what type of support do we have for those that are just interested in living on campus?
So let me start a little bit with the academic support that's available, because really the reason that people come to the university and want to live on campus is so that they can be successful academically and really achieve the goals that they have for themselves as well as their future career. We offer several different living learning communities that are focused on particular majors or affinity groups, and that allows students to really make connections with smaller cohorts of people that have similar interests, and that allows them to make more personal connections perhaps with faculty and other students that are in their majors. We also have faculty that live in the residence halls, and so that's a great opportunity to maybe have an interaction with a faculty member that can coach you on how to interact with those faculty that you're meeting in your classroom, and really broaden your access to the various expertise that is available on campus. We also have our residential education staff, and they approach the programming and the support that they offer in the residence halls through what's called a residential curriculum. And what that does is it is a very specific way to reach out and make individual connections with students. So we have resident assistants, which are student staff that live in the halls, that are really the resource and guides for any of our residents that have questions about the campus experience and classes and how to get connected throughout the environment. And so I think that that's a few of the things that we offer. And the underpinning of the residential curriculum sounds like a fancy name, but basically it's trying to make those connections and get students the resources that they need when they need them. So for example, in the beginning of the semester, you probably need more coaching, more tips about transition into college, maybe some study tips, maybe, you know, where are things around campus, how to get connected and involved in an organization, where maybe when you become a junior or senior, you need more tips about how to find internships and resume writing and those kinds of things. And so the residential curriculum allows us to build on that and provide the support to the students when they need it in the best way to connect with them.
Great. And Anna, you mentioned living learning communities. I'm excited to talk about that.
Sure.
I have a question later on about living learning communities, but I'm going to keep plugging this throughout the show, that next episode is all about living learning communities. So we're going to be covering the different options, how to apply, the room assignment process. So all of that good stuff is next episode, and you can learn more on our website about that, on the date and time for that.
Excellent.
So going back to support for residents, let's talk about the support that we have for those who are either current residents or families or students or admitted students through our bullpen booking. Would you like to talk about that a little bit?
Absolutely. That is a new option that we have provided through the pandemic. So there are many things that we have learned through this experience, and some of them are things that will carry on beyond when restrictions are lifted, et cetera. And one of the things that we introduced is called bullpen bookings. And what we know is that sometimes it can be difficult, especially in peak times, to get a hold of somebody in our office. And sometimes, especially our international students, we're finding trying to schedule a time where they can actually speak to a person about their issue, whether it is walking them through the application process, or how do you select a room, or just any nuance that people have that maybe is more of a personal experience that some of these events that you're hosting don't quite hit the mark. And so students have the ability to go on our website, and there's basically a calendar of appointments that are available, and they can pick, I think it's either 15-minute or 30-minute time slots on a particular day, and they put their name and their contact information. And then one of our housing services coordinators will reach out to the person, and it can be a current student, it can be a new student, it can be a parent, it can be a community member. Anybody that needs to connect with us or has questions about university housing, we will then call them back at the allotted time and the number that they have provided, and answer any questions that they may have. So we know that this is an unusual environment, and you know, where we usually have a lot of tours that are available, and or somebody can just pop in the office if they want to ask us a question. We want to make sure that we still have the ability to provide that personalized support for students and their families, so that they can feel comfortable, they can get all their questions answered, and prepare to become a bull and join our community.
Absolutely. And for those that are watching, you know, if you go on our website, it's one of the top banners right there in the middle. It's bullpen booking, and it's more information about the program and how you can go ahead and schedule something with one of our team members. So,
and you can, I just want to say, you can also still call our number directly and or email our office. So, you know, this is just an additive to the services that we're providing.
Absolutely. That's a great point. So Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, you can email us, call us, and we'll get to you as soon as we can. I know right now it's a busy time with being in the middle of room selection, students choosing to where they're going to school. So, it definitely is an added feature to have that one-on-one connection and a scheduled time with the bullpen booking. So we're having a lot of success with that. We're excited to have it up. So we talked a little bit about how this is a unique environment. It is a challenging time. It's been a unique and challenging year for sure, with a lot of changes. So let's talk about the changes that have been made to promote a healthy environment on campus now and what we see for in the future.
Sure. What we have done is we've really been very close partners with the medical experts that are on the campus, the public health experts that are on the campus, to try to provide an environment that mitigates as much risk as possible. And so some of that has included things that you see anywhere you are with regard to COVID, with regard to mask wearing, social distancing, hand washing, additional surface cleaning. We're really cognizant of people's awareness with regard to, you know, some of those basics that now everybody knows that mantra because they've been living with it for a year plus. And so we have implemented all of those mitigation strategies. If it is over the course of the last year that we had a student that tested positive or were exposed to the COVID-19 virus, we have a isolation location where we're able to support students through that process, and they are in very close contact with our student health services to make sure that you know, if they're feeling ill, that they get the support that they need. If they need to connect with professors, online classes, et cetera, we have a whole COVID care team that we implemented for them. We did have some restrictions with regard to the use of some of our space, some of our guest housing restrictions, et cetera. We're still waiting to hear what this is going to look like 2 months from now. Where we are right now looks very different than we were 2 months ago. And so as we have more people getting vaccinated and the rate of infection going down, we're expecting that we'll be able to have more of the freedoms that we're used to being able to have throughout the campus environment. As of now, we still have our masking requirements, our social distancing, et cetera. But we're hoping that, you know, in a couple of months, you know, maybe 3 months, that the vaccination rate will have achieved herd immunity, and that we will see the infection rate have a dramatic drop. And then that will allow us to return to some of the things that people associate with normally living on campus, with regard to visitation and access campus to be able to use spaces that may have some restrictions on them now.
Absolutely. So talking about vaccinations, let's touch on that. I know we talked earlier about before the show about the opportunity to share with our audience getting vaccinated and where they can do that, whether they are a current student, incoming, community member. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Absolutely. So throughout the Tampa area, there are many, many vaccine opportunities that are available, whether it's a federal site that is available, state site, or even some of the local grocery stores as well as pharmacies. But right here on the Tampa campus, as well as the St. Petersburg campus and the Sarasota Manatee campus, we have been holding vaccination events, and that allows students, faculty, staff, and their families to come and get vaccinated. We've been offering both the Pfizer vaccines as well as the Johnson & Johnson vaccines. Some of them have been pop-up events where there's no appointment needed, and others where there's an opportunity and ready availability to make appointments. And so we want to support our community in order to have as many people vaccinated as possible. And one of the benefits is that as we have more of our students, faculty, and staff vaccinated, they'll be able to have different isolation protocols or requirements on our campus pass completion or testing requirements related to travel, et cetera. So we're really trying to make it as easy as possible for people to get the vaccine and follow the CDC guidelines.
Perfect. Thank you, Anna. A question from an audience member. We have Chowdhury asking, hello, I'm an international student. And if I apply for housing, but due to unavoidable circumstances, I'm unable to travel from my country, what is the process? What are the next steps after that?
So welcome, and we're hoping that you are able to join us in the summer or in the fall, whenever your arrival time is planned. You know, we have worked very closely with our international student population because we understand that sometimes securing visas or being able to travel is out of their control. And so what we would ask is that those students that may have unusual circumstances or limitations work directly with USF World or the Office of Admissions potentially and the international students contact there. I was actually just speaking with one of my colleagues yesterday about some of the international students that may be having some challenges that believe that they'll be able to arrive, but you know, things are sort of changing on a dime. So we want to let you know that we understand those limitations and we will work with you. So we would just ask you to reach out and let us know what your circumstances are, and then we can let you know on an individual basis what next steps might look like.
Great. Thank you, Anna. So let's shift gears to talk about campus community. We talked about that a little bit with support and the benefits for living on campus, but that is such a huge part of it. The campus community, the friendships that you develop throughout your residential experience. So can we talk about some opportunities for students to connect and form those friendships on campus?
Absolutely. And that really is the core of the out-of-classroom experience, right? So you make the connections and you certainly have the academic endeavors that you're pursuing while you're in the classroom. And nowadays, classroom can be the four walls or it can be the Microsoft Teams or the Zoom screen with you. And there's one connection that you make with people that are sharing that academic pursuit or that interest level. But there's a whole life that happens beyond the classrooms. And those are the kinds of connections that we like to make. We have a very active residence hall association. There are leadership opportunities that are available there. There are certainly employment opportunities that are available throughout housing, whether that be the resident assistant, which many people are aware is the live-in positions that really are the guides and mentors of the students' experience. But we also have mail clerks, we have desk clerks, we have staff that work in the marketing office, we have staff that work in the assignments office, and even in the facilities office. So there are a lot of different opportunities to make connections through your work experience. And then what you will find with the people that are living on your hall, maybe even in your apartment, is that people are interested in different clubs and organizations. And so you may be living with somebody and your roommate is interested in the live action role play group that is on campus, and you may have the other roommate that's interested in the intramurals group. And so then those two sort of sets of friends that would be made by being roommates, you have that crossover and that connection. And so then your circle of friends widens. You know, it can be the shared experience of going to the dining hall together. You know, you're walking down the hall or you're walking out of the building and, you know, everybody's headed over to the hub or headed down to the JP dining facility. And so just having that familiarity of other residents and people that you know, you know, sharing a meal with them, you know, that's a great way to build community as well.
Absolutely. I love that example, Anna. Just me personally, from my residential experience, I have lifelong friends that, you know, a random roommate assignment turned into a bridesmaid of mine. So it's just, you always are going to be looking forward to making those connections. So you mentioned living learning communities. So this is my final plug with the living learning communities episode. Sure. For next week, or for next episode rather. But our entire next episode, I believe on May 12th, not next week, but the week after, is about living learning communities. So can you talk a little bit about what those are as a preview for next week? And that's my final question for you tonight.
Sure. The living learning communities, and I'm glad that we will have a segment to really dive deep into the process as well as the options that are available, because I won't be able to do them justice in a broad overview. But we have academic partners and campus partners throughout the university that we work with on either academically based or interest-based communities. And so a couple of examples would be the engineering living learning community or the Honors College living learning community or Stonewall Suites, which is a community that is focused on the support of LGBTQIA population that we have on campus. And just trying to break down a very large institution into a residential community, into a building, into a floor, into an interest group. And so the opportunity to really focus on that smaller cohort allows for some of those friendships to be made more quickly and or more deeply. And so we have fantastic partners with residential education staff that work with the academic partners that are on campus to really create some unique opportunities, whether they be used to be field trips. You know, this year they've been delivering a lot of that content through Bulls in the Cloud, which is our online platform for community connection. And so I really think that it's a great opportunity. It's something unique that you won't experience outside of the residential environment on campus. And so I would really encourage everybody to take a look at, I believe there are 11 different living learning communities that we offer, and see if anything speaks to you and see if that would be something that you think would benefit you. Easy study groups if you all have the same academic major, et cetera. So, and mm-hmm. while there are these 11 living learning communities, we also have space throughout the campus that is what you would call, it's not that it's not living or learning, it's mm-hmm. just that it doesn't have this same cohort focus.
Absolutely. And so before we jump off tonight, I do have one question that I want to touch on from Manuela, who's also an international student. Thanks for watching, Manuela. Manuela applied for housing a few weeks ago and selected a room, and then was told that they got a call to change the financial plan for their college funding. So what can I do to cancel? So in that response, Anna, would you be able to talk a little bit about cancellations and the different qualifications that are required to be eligible for that?
Sure. And the details are included in the student housing agreement, and a copy of those agreements are available online. But there is a section on cancellations within the student housing agreement that shows the eligibility. So if you meet one of those criteria, then you would be eligible to request a cancellation. If it is that you had not selected a room, then you would be able to cancel. If it is that you've selected a room, you need to make sure that you fall into one of those criteria. This is the same agreement that was in place when this particular student signed their contract, or anybody that is planning on living with us for the 2021-22 academic year. It's a little bit different than what we had last year, but I just wanted to make sure and refer people directly to the agreement. And if they meet one of those eligibility criteria, then they can go into the housing portal and request a cancellation, and then we'll review their circumstances and provide feedback as to whether or not that cancellation is approved.
Perfect. Thank you for that explanation, Anna.
Sure.
So we have some questions from the audience that I am saving for Dave that are room assignment type of questions. So we're going to jump off to a commercial break, but we will be right back. And thank you so much, Anna, for joining us tonight.
All right. Very good. And if we have any returning students, I want to encourage them to apply for the $800 residential scholarship. The deadline is April 30th.
You're right. That's Friday. So you should have received an email. Check your USF email for information about that. But thank you so much, Anna. Have a great night. And it's time for us to take a short break. But don't go back. And if you're watching, don't go anywhere. We'll be back with more USF Housing Live right after this.
Welcome home to Poplar Hall. Located on South Campus, Juniper Poplar, or JPH, is a beautiful residential community designed to give you everything you need to succeed. Poplar Hall is connected to Juniper Hall by a common lobby on the first floor. Poplar Hall offers suite-style rooms. Each suite consists of two double occupancy rooms that share a bathroom which is cleaned weekly. Each bedroom has its own sink outside the bathroom. Every bedroom has a bed, dresser, chair, and desk for every student, as well as a shared closet space and a window. You can maximize your space by requesting to have your bed raised up to 5 feet high. This way, your desk and your dresser can fit underneath. Each floor has a full kitchen with plenty of counter space to cook your favorite meals. When you don't feel like cooking, you have easy access to a dining hall, Juniper Dining, right on the first floor. Here, you can find a wide variety of options that meet different dietary preferences and needs. Across from Juniper Dining is the first floor service desk, where you can go if you have an issue with your key or have a package ready for pickup. This is also where you can find your mailbox, as well as a printer that all students can access. When it's time to do your laundry, visit the laundry room, also on the first floor. You can use quarters or swipe your USF ID to pay with Bull Bucks. It's up to you. Need groceries? A quick snack? Drop by the Pod Market just outside, where you can find all of your favorite snacks to fuel your study sessions. Have some downtime? Grab your sunscreen and take a walk or jog around our beautiful campus, or reserve a spot to study at the library just a short walk away. To learn more about our housing options, visit usf.edu/housing. Get ready to live the Bulls life.
Welcome back. I'm Julia O'Hara, and if you're just now joining us, this is USF Housing Live, and we're here to help you prepare to live the Bulls life at USF. So ask us your questions in the comments, and we will answer you live on the show. Our second guest this evening is the Associate Director for Operations and Outreach at USF Housing and Residential Education, and of course, a USF Housing Live regular, Dave Kloiber. Hi, Dave. How's it going?
Good evening, Julia. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks so much for joining us. We have a collection of questions that I've saved just for you that we can start off with. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Awesome. So in the beginning of the broadcast, Lisa, thank you for your question and thanks for hanging in there with us when we waited for Dave to answer your question. Once you are accepted into a living learning community, when do you get a room assignment and find out who your roommates are?
Sure. So we've actually started doing room assignments about maybe a month ago. And really, it all depends on when we get the information from the LLC partner, where they want you to be assigned. And if your application is ready for assignment, then we can actually make that assignment. We're actually trying to make those assignments every day or every other day right now. And I know we've already done it at least once or twice this week. And so we intend to keep going until we've got everybody assigned.
Perfect. And then Minnie asked, hello, I was recently accepted, congratulations, and wondering what housing selection would I choose to obtain my own room but share a bathroom with another person?
Boy, to have a single room, and congratulations on your acceptance, that's a wonderful achievement. To have your own room and yet be sharing a bathroom, you'd probably want to look at either a apartment style, which are single rooms with a shared bath, a kitchen, and a living room. Or you could try for a traditional room that that is a single room, or a suite room that is a single room, and then the bathroom would either be part of your unit if it's in a suite, or down the hall if you're in a traditional.
So that actually sets me up perfectly for the next question. The first question that I guess I planned for you was, what are the different types of room styles that we have on campus? So you mentioned traditional, you mentioned suite, and you mentioned apartment. Can you give a little bit more detail about what each of those look like?
Sure can. So that's actually all three of them are all of our types on campus. But to begin with traditional, it's really what you probably, or your parents or guardians think of when they think of living on a college campus. You know, you're in a double room or maybe a single room or sometimes even a triple room or more, but we don't have more here at USF. And the bathroom is down the hall. And so it's a great opportunity to meet a lot of people because you can't do everything inside the privacy of your own unit. Believe it or not, you'll meet a lot of people in that bathroom down the hall because everybody needs to use the bathroom. Not that you're all using it together. There is privacy in our common area bathrooms, but everybody has to go there eventually, and so it's a great opportunity for you to meet people as you're going to and from the bathroom, and maybe while you're brushing your teeth. Then we have the suite style. It's kind of that halfway point between the traditional and what we call the most independent living, which is our apartment style. The suites are it's either a single room or two double rooms that share a bathroom. So if it's I should say not a single room, a single bedroom or two bedrooms that share a bathroom. Now, they could be single rooms, they could be double rooms. But the key there for a suite is it has the bathroom attached to the unit. And we do offer a single suite in Maple Hall this year, where you've got two single rooms that share a bathroom. Or we have double suites that are doubles that share a bathroom in Poplar and Juniper Hall. And then we also have similar options in the Village, except in the Village, two bedrooms are never connected by a bathroom. It's always a bedroom on its own, either with a bathroom or traditional, which is down the hall. And then finally we have, one other great note about the suite style, our staff will clean your bathroom once a week. And so it's a great option and a great halfway step to being totally independent, which is what we look at when we look at our apartment style. And our apartment style is generally a single or a double bedroom. The apartment has a kitchen living room combination, and it also has bathrooms within the unit. And so one or two bathrooms within the unit. And so you could have your own room, but be sharing the living room, kitchen, and bathroom with the other folks in your apartment. The important thing to note about our apartment style is that we clean the bathroom before you arrive, and we'll clean the bathroom after you leave. So it's really on you and your apartment mates, roommates, whatever you want to call them, to make sure that your apartment's being kept up and clean, because you never want to have your friend go into your bathroom when it's all messy and dirty. You want to make sure that your bathroom's nice and clean so that you, when you make friends, you keep friends. Always
exactly.
A good idea.
Exactly. You maintain those good roommate relationships. Not sure if you mentioned this, though, Dave. The community restroom with the traditional style, that is cleaned daily by staff.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Yeah. And we have a viewer, Alexander. Alexander, mm-hmm. Thanks for watching. Alexander's filling out their housing dining application, and they're on the room preferences section. Is there a reference page that shows what type of room entails? For example, RHO double suite room. So it sounds like Alexander's on the St. Pete yes. housing application.
Which is fine. I can answer that.
Right, exactly. So I just wanted to move. We just went over all of the Tampa options, which we have some similarities with the St. Pete options. But let's talk about what the St. Petersburg campus housing options look like.
Sure. For the 21-22 academic year, they are going to be offering suite style and apartment style. Now, they have a couple of different varieties of suites, and I'm going to try and bring up a file so that I can kind of use a cheat sheet here, because I know Tampa very well. I don't know St. Pete as well, but I do have information about it, and so I will try to provide as much information as possible, because I want to make sure that our viewers are getting the best experience possible.
And while you do that, Dave, so our website, either website, so housing.usf.edu or housing.usf/edu/St. Petersburg, I think it is. I'm not sure. If you have it up and you can look up the URL.
I do have it up.
Yeah, but both of them, what I'm trying to get at is both of them have options to go and look at all of the different housing options, and mm-hmm. the layouts are included
yes.
on all of those too.
And the web address for St. Petersburg is usfsp.edu/housing.
Yes, that's it. That's what I was trying to say.
Okay. And so technically they have three different building styles on the campus. They have Pelican Apartments, so that's their apartment style. And they offer a four-bedroom single, a two-bedroom single, which are actually, and then they offer the studio double, which is basically, it's a studio where the beds are in the main room. The only thing separate, really, the beds are in the main room with the kitchen and the living area, but the bathroom is actually separate, obviously. And so those are the apartments. And then they offer Osprey Suites, which come in a two-bedroom double, a four-bedroom single, and a three-bedroom single. And there are actually some two-bedroom single options that might be available as well. And then finally, though I'm not sure they're offering it this year, there is Ibis Hall, and that will offer double occupancy suites, so a double room with an attached bathroom.
Perfect. So if Alexander wants to see those options, they can log on to the St. Petersburg Housing website and go under Housing Option tab, I believe. Is that where you're looking?
Actually, I'm looking at a PowerPoint.
Oh, okay. Well, I think it's also on the website.
Presentation
right.
that we did on Saturday. On yeah. Saturday. Another thing to note is that if he's filling out the 21-22 academic year application right now, he could put his preferences on there, but he's going to be encouraged to contact the office and set up a time where he can actually go over what options are available, ask more questions about those options, and then actually be assigned on the phone as to where he wants to live for the fall.
Great. And that's a good opportunity to bring up the difference between the St. Petersburg room selection process and the Tampa room selection process. Tampa's very different in that you go into the housing portal and have a live look at the available rooms, and you go in and select yourself mm-hmm. Or for your roommate group. And St. Petersburg is just, as you said, you put your preferences in, and then at this point, at this date, you can call and go through those options together and make the
Correct.
Decision that's best for you.
And I believe that St. Pete will eventually make it to the point where they're going to do the online option. But for now, right now, they're going to take that great customer service approach and work with each student individually.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. And we have some questions about some different dining and some different things that are coming in. But I want to stick with the room type before we move on.
Sure.
So Minnie had a follow-up question asking the difference between single rooms and super single rooms.
Sure. So a single room is a room that's designed for one person. And so it's going to have one set of furniture in it. And it's going to be a little bit smaller than, let's say, a double room that's designed for two people. But our super single is a double room that we're selling to just one individual. And so there is a higher cost to it because you're getting more square footage for yourself. And if you're in Beta, Castor, and Maple, where we have basically designated super singles, we have taken out that second set of furniture minus the second dresser, because we always know people want more dresser space. And so we are going to leave that second dresser in there. But we've taken out the extra bed, the extra desk, the extra chair. And you'll have a lot more space to have in your room if you choose to have one of those super singles. And so that's the difference. Now, let's say you're in a building in Juniper or Poplar, and maybe you're in a room by yourself and you're like, you know what, I'd really like to see, explore what that option would be for a super single. You can contact our office and see if it's possible to create another super single. I can tell you right now, though, that we're not creating super singles in the Village, in our newest buildings. And so if you're in Summit, Endeavor, Horizon, Pinnacle, or Beacon, you're not going to be able to create a super single.
Right. And a question on that topic from Tanya is, do you have any single rooms with a private bathroom?
We have very few of those, and they're located in the Village. Mm-hmm. I can tell you that they go extremely quickly if they are available. In the beginning of the selection process, we hold most of those for our students with disabilities and medical conditions that require a bathroom. And so you won't find that there are many of them available, if at all. And they may become available as we get into June, if there are any left. But generally, we end up using them all for our students with disabilities or medical conditions.
And another question from Debbie is, what are the approved appliances for traditional housing? Refrigerator, microwave, air fryer. So we can go over that briefly, but there is a list of policies on our website too that will have all of that information. But off the top of your head, Dave, what are some things that you can and can't bring in those restrictions?
So you can have a refrigerator up to 4.5 cubic feet. So for me, it's up to my thigh. For most people, it's up to their hip. I'm just really tall. You can also have a microwave up to 1,000 watts. Anything that has its own heating element, so maybe an air fryer, maybe a coffee pot, you're going to want to make sure that that's eligible to be used in your room. So before you go out buying these items, please call our office directly and we'll try to get you that answer on your specific product. I believe that Keurigs are okay, but I'm not positive. Sometimes there's debate on what is and isn't. So before you go and spend money on things, I want to make sure that you're trying to get the actual answer. So please contact our office individually.
Yes. And we just commented on the stream too, a move-in checklist. So that is a great resource for mm-hmm. all the things that you should and you shouldn't bring. And communication with your roommate is definitely key, because you don't want, I mean, maybe you do want two refrigerators, but maybe you don't need two refrigerators. So having that open communication, I'll bring the refrigerator, you bring the microwave, is always good to
And do you talk. Really need two 40-inch TVs or two 50-inch TVs?
Maybe, probably Dave. Not. You never know.
Yeah, maybe. You never know.
So a couple other questions, and then we're going to get into my questions that I planned for you, but I want to get through some of these audience questions. The next one is about dining. So Todd is asking about the meal plans. What places are covered under the unlimited plan, and what places only use the dining dollars and cash?
Sure. So the dining plans, so the NE15, the Bull Block, I think it's 175, might be 165. It's changed recently. And the all-you-can-eat or all-you-care-to-eat plans are available for use in the all-you-can-eat dining facilities. So the Hub, Champion's Choice, Juniper Dining. You may be able to use it for a meal swipe in Argos Exchange, but you'll want to verify that. And the dining dollars can be used to any of the dining operator facilities throughout campus. There are a few exceptions which are not operated by dining. And so I believe the Starbucks in the library, I do not believe is operated by, no, actually the Starbucks in the bookstore is not operated by dining. But the Starbucks in Juniper Hall, the Starbucks in the library, the Starbucks in Pinnacle Hall, those are all operated by dining. The food court in the Marshall Center is operated by dining. And they'll have a complete list of what is and is not permissible on their website. So I always encourage you to go to, I believe it's www.campusdish.com/USF, or is it USF Campus Dish?
You know what? We have someone awesome on social media right now. Taylor is going to drop those in the comments.
There we
we'll make
go.
Sure that we get the link to the dining website. All right.
I lost my little mic for you.
So. Yeah, no worries. As long as
make sure you can hear me.
I can hear you. As long as you can hear me, we're in good shape. So, Dave, I'm going to take a break from the questions coming in from the audience, but we do appreciate them, so keep them coming, and we'll go back to them in a minute. But I just want to make sure that we go over the application process and the application steps for someone who may just be joining us and is not sure if they want to live on campus or even attend USF. I want to make sure that we can give them the information they need to apply for housing. So what is that process, and what are the steps that need to be taken in order to select a room on campus?
Sure. So everything begins with, for housing anyway, by completing your housing application. If you're admitted to the university, you're going to be able to log into the housing portal and complete your housing application. Once your housing application is submitted, the very next business day, you'll be assessed a $50 application fee. That is non-refundable. And we ask that you pay that fee as soon as possible. But in addition, you'll need to make sure that you've registered for orientation and that your immunizations that are required for housing, which are your hepatitis B and your meningitis, and if you're an international student, your TB screening, are either satisfied, either you decline or show proof of the immunization or the vaccination for hepatitis B and meningitis, and you've shown or have a temporary waiver on your TB screening. So once all of those are done, then you're ready for an assignment and you can log in and complete your selection.
Great. And let's see how to follow up to that. Is there a deadline to select your room on campus? And how a little overview of how the room selection process works.
Sure. We would ask that you select your room by June 30th. If you don't select your room by then, it's not too late to get an assignment, but you're not going to be able to do it on your own. If that date changes, we will notify you. It will be available on our website. However, when you want to go in and select your room, you'll log into the housing portal. You'll click the assign button, and that will take you into a place where you can see whether or not your application is ready for assignment. And what kind of assignment are you looking for? Are you in a special population like the ACE program, the SSS program, maybe you're in the Honors LLC? You can click on one link to get into your program-specific room selection process. If you're a student that's in you're a general student, or you're in one of those programs but you don't want to live in the program-specific area, if that's possible, like the ACE program, then you'll just go and click the general room selection tab. You'll be able to search by a variety of different options as to what style room it is. Is it a suite, an apartment, or a traditional? Is it a double, a single, or a triple room, bedroom, I should say? Does the unit have a kitchen? Does it have a common, a bathroom down the hall, a common bathroom, a shared bathroom, or a private bathroom? There are a bunch of different ways you can search our list of available beds. And then it will either show you a map of where everything is, and anything that's available is shaded in green. Or you can have a list show up, and that's really just your preference. And you can toggle the list or the map.
And when it comes to roommates, so if you want to live with someone in particular, how does that work?
Sure. There are a couple different ways you could do it. You can select your room on your own, and your friend can select another space within that unit. Or you can form what we call a roommate group. And so any student that's ready for room selection, so they've completed the first four steps. Once those are done, they can actually join or form a roommate group and invite people to join if they're forming it, or be invited if they're someone who knows somebody who's starting a group. And once people agree to be in a roommate group, one of the individuals in that group can actually go in and assign for everybody.
Perfect. And just a shout out here for our Class of 2025 Facebook page. So if you're an incoming student and wanting to live on campus and looking for a roommate, if you're not sure who you want to live with yet, that's a great place to join and introduce yourself and find people with similar interests or hobbies that you may want to be roommates with.
So I did get some more information on appliances that are not permitted in traditional or suite style.
Okay, let's hear it.
Air fryers, toasters, George Foreman grills, hot plates, Instapots, or the pressure cookers, roasters, popcorn poppers, and deep freezers, so large freezers, are not permitted. Now, that's not an exhaustive list. That's a list of common questions that we get. Now, if you're in an apartment, you can have those items. However, just remember, the apartment's not giant. So you'd have to be able to fit them all. And so just be sure that you're not having four people bring an air fryer. You probably only need one for the apartment. You probably don't need four toasters and four hot plates. Or actually, you don't even need a hot plate for an apartment. You have a kitchen with a stove, so you should be fine there. But like you said earlier, you definitely want to have a conversation with your roommate or your suite mates or your apartment mates as to what appliances you will bring.
Exactly. And you just touched on this, actually, in apartment style. Victoria is asking if you will have a dishwasher in an apartment style kitchen in Magnolia specifically.
If it's a four-person apartment, you have four dishwashers, you and all three of your roommates. No, we don't install dishwashers in our apartment styles.
I have never heard that joke from you, Dave. That was the first time I heard that. That's a good one. I might steal it.
You can.
I didn't
copyright it, so don't worry.
And now we've gotten two questions about move-in from Abdullah and Alyssa. Thank you both for watching. We're asking about move-in dates for fall 2021. So what can we say about move-in so far, Dave?
So the first day that housing is in effect currently for the fall is August 19th. That's a Thursday. We are still looking into the whole plan for moving in. We have found that making those appointments to move in worked really well in the past year. And so we're probably going to continue with that practice, though please don't go jump on the housing portal right now to try and set up your time because it's not there. But more information will follow. We will have our moving in webpage updated for fall once we finish doing move in for summer. But I would anticipate that the week of, I believe it's, let me see, 19th, so it'd be 18th, 17th, 16th, the 15th through, the 15th would be the earliest arrival date for the fall. And that's for people who maybe have a special program that needs them to arrive early. Maybe they're attending orientation, but orientation is virtual this year. But generally, that would be a reason why someone would arrive early if they have that last orientation session. But most of our students will be arriving between the 19th and the 22nd.
And just a little information, too, about what the move-in process, it's all being finalized right now. So we will have more information in the summer. But Residents can expect another staggered move-in where you would go and sign up for your move-in appointment, mm-hmm. as well as not a centralized check-in location like we've done in years past with the drive-through or at the MSC, but more spread out in that way. So we will have an announcement hopefully in the next couple of weeks, maybe the next month once we get into the summer with how that will look. Going back up to a couple more questions, we have time for a few more questions tonight. Let's talk about parking. We have a question here from Dello asking if parking is included as part of the housing package. So if you live on campus, what is the parking requirement for you to purchase, or is it included?
It would be something you'd have to purchase. I'm not sure what the rates are for students. I know that as a staff member, I pay about $290 for the year. I believe the pass for the student generally ranges between $250 and $260 for the entire 12-month period. But more information will be available, and I believe parking permits typically go on sale on or around August 1st for the fall, spring, and following summer.
Mm-hmm. And the Parking and Transportation Services website will have all of those.
Yep.
Rates and information. For those that are watching that are attending the St. Petersburg campus, Alexander is asking, is it the same move-in date for St. Pete? Do we have any information about St. Pete's move-in?
They start on their housing starts on the same day as ours. Typically, they are able to move in their students on weekdays, so I would anticipate a minimum of the 19th and the 20th. But they may allow students to arrive earlier in that week. Again, that's all right now in discussions. A lot of it depends on our status to reopening, mm-hmm. In terms of our COVID phases, and so a lot of that still is being discussed. But again, I would anticipate, again, a staggered move-in, as they've also done in the past year. And again, that request to move in for a particular time will be available through the housing portal once everything is arranged and determined.
And a follow-up to the parking question, to go back to that, mm-hmm. Janie's asking, what is the best parking pass to get for a student living on campus? And correct me if I'm wrong, but that would be a residential parking pass, because that gives
actually
you access.
The only one they can purchase.
Okay. And that gives you access to the residence halls by being able to park closer than a student or a faculty or staff member. So it's the best one to get. For the most part, what I've noticed is that it's right next to the buildings that you need to
be. The R lots are near the residence halls,
right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. And let's get a couple more in here. Chris is asking, or is saying, I'm not a Florida resident, but I am a veteran who qualifies for in-state tuition. How do I document that to proceed with my daughter's housing selection?
Oh boy, that's, it's not really necessary to document that for your housing selection, but if you want to ensure that you have set up prior to selecting a room, I would encourage you to reach out to admissions, because admissions will work with you to set up your Florida residency, or at least your in-state tuition billing if you're not technically a resident in the state of Florida. And so work with the admissions office, also work with our Veterans Affairs office. They'll be very helpful as well. And once your student is here, once they start classes, then any residency questions will then shift to the registrar's office, not to the admissions office.
Okay. And I saved this question for last because I like this question a lot. I like all the questions that have happened, but this one's fun. Suresh is asking, do you have cobra, alligator, or snakes in campus or residential areas? So I'm going to take that one of two ways. Either can you bring them to the residence halls, which the answer is no. Please don't do that. And second, what kind of wildlife do we have on campus? I have never seen any of those things on campus or even in the Tampa area. Well, I guess maybe I've seen an alligator before, but definitely not on campus.
You've probably seen an alligator.
But I want to talk about the ducks and the squirrels on campus, because if you're looking for wildlife, that is what you're going to find at the university.
They actually have Facebook groups.
They do, which you, if you're watching tonight, should definitely go follow the ducks and the squirrels of USF on the campus here, because if you come to USF, you have to decide if you are team squirrel or team duck, because there are many of both. And I don't find either of them dangerous. I've not seen any dangerous side to either of those animals. But
a little alerting sometimes when the squirrel suddenly pops out of the garbage can
that
you're trying to throw something out from.
Yeah, they're very friendly. But Dave, in your experience, have you seen any of those types of that type of wildlife on campus?
This is Florida.
Yeah.
So are there snakes? Yes. Are there alligators? An alligator could be in any water, freshwater area on campus. And yes, there have been alligators seen on campus in some of the larger ponds, not Castor Pond. I don't think anybody's ever seen one in Castor Pond, which is right in the center of campus. But I know that at the golf course, the Claw, which is part of USF, there are certainly alligators in those ponds. But more than likely, there are alligators in any pond that you see in Florida. And so the rule of thumb is don't bother them. They shouldn't bother you. And be careful during mating season. And never, ever try to feed one.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, I was at a resort and I saw a bunch of people feeding an alligator. And all of a sudden they had to run because the alligator got hungrier and wanted to come for more.
Wow.
And so don't play with them. Don't feed them. It's not a good idea.
Yeah, no,
but,
I would. Yeah.
Yes, we have. We technically have rattlesnakes in the Tampa area.
Okay.
They're usually they call them a pygmy rattler.
They're a small
version, but we do have them.
Suresh, from my experience, Suresh should ask the question. You don't have to worry about snakes or alligators crawling around campus. That's the short answer.
I don't think I've never seen one personally.
Right.
Let's put it on either squirrels and ducks all the time.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we look
snakes,
for.
Yeah.
Okay. So while we had that discussion about snakes and alligators, we have received a few more questions. I know we are at 8, but I'm going to go a little bit over just so we can get to these questions tonight.
Sure.
Andriana is asking, are you allowed to switch rooms with your roommate during the year? So you're allowed to switch rooms with your roommate during the year. Taking that question as, are you allowed to switch rooms during the year, I guess, is, we'll take the question that way.
In a general year, yes. One of our policies during COVID has been a restriction on the ability to do room changes unless, say, we're in emergency need. But in a regular year, yes, we do permit room changes, but it has to be approved. You can't just say, you're in the A room and I'm in the D room. I want to switch. No, you're not doing that. You can't just switch on your own. You can request to do a switch and there'll be a form available on the housing portal after the third week of the term, where you can request that as long as we are doing room changes. And you can even move from building to building. There may be some restrictions on building to building depending on which building you're going to. But yes, we do allow room changes. But you want to talk to either the RA or the RLC or contact the assignment office, and we can provide you a little bit more information about that.
Thank you, Dave. And Mark is asking, is the campus going to be reopened 100% by the start of the fall semester?
That's the million-dollar question.
Mm-hmm.
Our hope is that we will be reopening much of our campus and we'll be having in-person activities and having in-person classes. Right now, to my knowledge, we are offering primarily in-person classes for the fall.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, over this past year, I ran a little report once, and I found that about a third of our residents living on campus were actually all online, but they still wanted to live on campus. It is a great experience. It's a great choice, regardless of what modality you're learning in, whether you're in person all the time, it's hybrid, or you're online, or a mixture of all those. You really can't put a price tag on the experience that you have living on campus. I still talk to people I met when I was in college living on campus. I had roommates and friends that were in my wedding, even though that was, 10 years after I graduated from college.
I just gave that same example to Anna when we were talking about the residential community earlier.
Research has shown that even if you live on campus, even for only 1 year, you're going to have a better chance to graduate and graduate quicker than those who have never lived on campus. And so it's really important. If you have the ability to live on campus, even if it's only for 1 year, take that opportunity, because you're going to meet people that may be your friends for life.
Mm-hmm. Great point. And Lila asked, they are doing summer online, so do I have to apply for summer housing as well? The answer to that is no, you don't have to live on campus if you're doing online classes over the summer. But like Dave just said, many students live on campus and do courses just online, and it's definitely worth it. So it's definitely something to consider. If you do want to start off in the summer, live on campus, start making friends, really start your college experience at that time, we highly encourage it, but it is not a requirement. And then last question of the night, Dave, we have seen this on social media a few times. So Maria is asking, will vaccines be required to attend the university in the fall?
Okay, at this time, vaccines are not required. If you remember my comments earlier about immunizations, we're not requiring the meningitis vaccine. We're not requiring the hepatitis B vaccine. We recommend that you get the vaccine. If you're someone who's traveling, having the vaccine would help you in that travel. And so at this time, we are not requiring the vaccine. My guess is we're not going to require it, but I'm not in charge. I do what I'm advised by our university. But definitely for those who are on the fence about getting the vaccine, I can tell you I've had both mine. I think it can only help you. I mean, certainly some people have had an adverse effect to it. I know I had a pretty horrible one-day experience after I got my second dose, but it went away the very next day and I felt fine again. And now I can feel confident that that I'm a little bit more protected from at least COVID.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like the flu. It's worse than the flu. And so a lot of people, myself included, didn't always get the flu shot. But I got the COVID vaccine. And so I can only encourage you to do it, but it's a personal decision you're going to need to make on your own or with the advice of your parents or guardians. But I would err on the side of caution and get it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that, Dave. And I believe that we have gotten through most of, if not all of the questions from the audience. So thank you so much, everybody, for asking all these great questions. And stay with us throughout the season. This is just the beginning of so much fun we're going to have all the way through August. So every Wednesday. And Dave, thank you so much for joining us. I hope you have a great night.
I will. Thank you for having me again. And I look forward to our next episode, which I think I'm on again.
Probably. I feel like you're... We're just going to have you on for every episode, our campus expert.
It wouldn't be the first time.
Yeah, that's true. All right. Thank you, Dave. And if you have any additional questions about living on campus at USF, you can reach our office by email at housing@usf.edu or by phone at 813-974-0001. And a few reminders before we go. The summer 2021 and fall spring 21-22 housing applications are open now. So be sure to submit your housing application as soon as possible so you can select your room on campus and live the Bulls life this year. And be sure to join us for our next episode of Housing Live on Wednesday, May 12th at 7 p.m. Eastern. We will be talking about living learning communities at USF. You can watch on our Facebook or YouTube page, the USF Class of 2025 Facebook group, or the USF Parent and Family Engagement Facebook page. USF Housing Live is produced by Housing and Residential Education at the University of South Florida in Tampa. Our motto is best place to live, best place to work, and best place to learn. Thank you to tonight's guests, Anna Hernandez and Dave Kloiber, for joining me this evening. Thank you to our production crew, to you, our viewers, and of course, there's always just one last thing. Go Bulls! Good night, everyone.